Welcome, everyone.
Hey, everyone.
Happy to see you here in our Facebook book group live, question and answer live.
This is number 7. Believe it or not, we've been going at this for 7 weeks so far. So I'm going to start us off with asking for any questions you have. Go ahead and post them into the comments, and we'll get to those. We have a few announcements we'll be covering today, and then we'll get to the questions at the end. So let me start off. We had one question earlier this week about whether or not they posting something to the entire group. What is the protocol for doing that? What is the protocol for posting something to the entire group? And the purpose of having this as a group is so that we can interact with each other and interact with the ideas and things like that. At the same time, we don't want to flood the group with, you know, hundreds of different posts coming from every different direction. So we're going to try something. Every week we will post a post that's basically a playground post. I don't know if you've heard of the parking lot where you park things that they don't really fit exactly with the topic of the lesson, but it's something the group is interested in. So we're going to post a playground post where if it's something that it doesn't seem to fit as a comment to whatever we're working on as a group, but it's going to benefit the group, that's the place to put it. So there's a place. And it's kind of like Stacy did the introduce yourself post where, hey, tell us who you are and what something about you, what your business, anything you want to brag about. It's kind of that idea where we're creating a space. So there is a clear place to put that kind of stuff. And
we'll post it on Fridays right after the live.
Yeah. So we'll test that out, see how it goes, and hopefully that creates the framework in order to encourage that kind of sharing with the group and benefit all of us. The next thing is we're hitting stage 2 next week, and super exciting.
Yes, we're so excited.
So
let me talk about
that. Yeah, why don't you talk about that, and then we'll give a couple of recommendations.
Yes, so going into the stage 2, it's called the translation stage. So what we've done is we've given you, stage 1 was the overview, right? Where we talked about all of the concepts, all of the 9 concepts, and then we said, you don't need to be accountable for this, you don't need to delve in, don't try and apply it, just kind of keep a light approach, an easy approach, relaxed approach to the concepts. And so we talked about how you could just kind of sit back and relax, you know. And
it's a movie preview.
Yes, yes. And so that stage is finished. We're almost finished. Just a couple more days.
Sunday is the last one.
Yeah.
Right?
Yep. Yeah. And then when we go into the translation stage, what we're doing is we're creating a space for you to take the ideas from the kind of overview. I'm not sure yet what they are. I wouldn't be able to explain them all in detail. I haven't studied them. Just take it from that kind of just first familiarization, I guess, with the ideas. Take them to a more, you feel more comfortable with the ideas, where they make sense to you. And you would, if someone said, hey, what's concept number 2? And you'd be like, oh yeah, I know what that is. And let me tell you a little bit about it. You know, so we want to be able to make it, or we want to help you with this process. It's not something you're going to do on your own. We're going to guide you through it step by step. We're dividing up each of the concepts into really small sections. And so we want you to take that small section and put it in your own words. And so this is like key, critical. When I say put it in your own words, don't just copy and paste it and don't just say, oh, this is where they talked about this and this and this, but not really know in your own way of being, your own words, your own thoughts, not really knowing what it is we're saying, but what we wanted in your own thoughts. And so come up with your own stories, your own analogies, your own symbols, like make it your own. And by making it your own, you actually make it so that you can keep it. It won't just like kind of be there only while you're looking at it, and then when you're not looking at it, you forget it. To really understand it, this is the translation stage, and so we call it that because it's like learning a foreign language. Mm-hmm. If you've just heard the language spoken, you won't be able to speak it. And if you're familiar with the words, if you're not, we talk about this as we go. I don't want to get into it too deeply.
Oh, yeah. So we're just giving a quick, brief, kind of this is what's coming, but starting Monday, every we'll go into detail on exactly what the translation
is. Yeah, I started to go into it. And this is what it means.
And then you're going to do this, and then you're going to do this. So that detail is coming. But we wanted to make an announcement beforehand because you will be creating your own guidebook. So some kind of physical guidebook that you will keep a record of things in your words. And so if you want to do that in a real notebook, if you want to do that in a digital copy, Evernote, OneNote, whatever format that works best for you, you want to have that ready for Monday.
Yep, so if you're a handwritten paper kind of person, get your notebook, a special notebook just for this, and then as you're going and doing each section, I recommend leaving a few blank pages between, maybe even more than you think you need. If you need, like 4 or 5 or 6 or something, put them between because you're going to be adding to it later. Things will make sense. You'll have experiences you'll want to jot in there that will help it make more sense. And so, so give yourself some buffer room between each concept as you're going. But having that either written or digital, just having it all in one place, all of your ideas in one place. And I also wanted to say that when I started, I got so excited telling you about the guidebook and the translation stage. I might have overwhelmed you. I might have made it sound like it was too big.
I have to learn a foreign language. What?
And I just want you to know that it is small chunks. And just really, this little idea, and think about it. And the more you can, put it in your own words and play with the ideas in your own way, the more it will make sense and the more it will stick.
And there's one comment that you could use a binder. I like that idea because then you can add pages and take pages out.
Well, that's a great idea.
But whichever kind of, what format works for you, knowing that you will be expanding the ideas as you go.
Yeah, and I just wanted to add that there are parts of it where we say, come up with a symbol or for something, and then go and put that symbol next to every heading or in each concept. And so digitally, you just need to be able to create a symbol to put it on there. So it's just one of those little details that I didn't know. I didn't think about ahead of time when I was creating it with my handwritten one. I didn't think, I'm going to put a smiley face here, but if I do it digitally, can I just put a smiley face here? Just something to think of. Okay. So,
yeah. Okay. Yes. So that is for the guidebook. And we've covered what the translate. We're starting with the translation stage. We'll give full details starting Monday. It'll take a couple of days to cover just what exactly it is, and then you'll actually know what it is and be going forward. I think on Wednesdays, it's starting Monday. Yes.
Yes, starting Monday.
Starting Monday. Okay, so I think we're to the question stage.
Yep.
So we have a couple of questions already.
Okay, so we're going to start with this one. Someone said they were curious about the concept of this. It was the signals to approach chronic health conditions, chronic pain, and etc. What are your thoughts on this? And so one of the things to think about that we focused on in that section when we talk about signals, we're talking about information from your body or from your environment, and that the information comes to you in a neutral way. It's just information, and then you get to decide what to do with it. And so a lot of signals we get, they can be ignored or they are ignored. We're not even really thinking about them. A lot of them are ignored, right? Because we get
so many.
And so, but some of them come to our awareness, and we actually would want to change something in our environment. We get this bit of information, and then we're like, I want to change this. And so then we have the power, freedom to change the thing. But there are times where you get information and there's nothing you would want to change. Like, you've already decided in this situation, even if I get more information, I probably wouldn't change my decision. We always want to be aware of the information in case something does change, like something that is a threat to our health or, something that we do need to be aware of that we would change. But a lot of the information is just a little bit more information, and we don't really need it to change our direction. So I have two examples of this, and one is with mosquito bites. If you get a mosquito bite, you've probably heard that you shouldn't scratch them, but did you know that if you don't scratch them at all, like if you don't even mindlessly kind of scratch it and then realize it's a mosquito bite, if you can get in the habit of just, I just tap mine. Yeah. you don't even really need to touch it, right? You should just look at it. But for some reason, I just like pat it. I think I replaced the scratch with the pat. So whenever I have an itch, I just pat it and then think, should I scratch this? And if it could be a mosquito bite, don't scratch it, because if you cannot scratch it at all, it will get better very quickly, within minutes or even 30 minutes at the latest. Like, unless it's a really venomous one, a really bad one, which I've had before in Thailand and different places. But when you get that itch, then think, oh, should I scratch it or not? And then let's say that awareness comes a little bit later and you feel the itch again, and then you feel like you want to scratch it. It's information. The itch is information, right? But you don't want to change your action, right? So you can, and this might sound a little bit, it's hard to explain, but you can appreciate the information that the signal is giving you, and then kind of let it go. And I don't even know if letting it go is the right word, because it's not like you're ignoring it, because sometimes people say let it go and it means ignore it, and you're not ignoring it. And if you feel like you have to use willpower to ignore it, then definitely, what do? We just, if you feel like you're like fighting against yourself, then really just be like, try not to use that fighting feeling and that willpower feeling, but just, you know, just be okay with it. And you can change your environment. I'm not saying change it. So in this case, if you used a boost or a placebo, something that kind of helps you out, you could put a cold compress or a hot compress, or if you have some kind of numbing cream or a natural, like, you know, eucalyptus or something. We like to use tiger balm that you can't get everywhere in the world, but you can get it in Thailand and on Amazon. But if your mind just keeps going to the itch, keeps going, and you're just like, I'm just fighting myself, then use a boost. Something to kind of help you forget about it and tune that signal back down. So the mosquito bite is one. And then also, I had a member of my team who had this really great idea to talk about, if you were hungry while you were taking a test and that hunger signal came up, you're not going to change anything in your environment. You're going to finish taking that test. And so if you realize that you can tune into that signal more, meaning think about it. Do you want to read it?
No, go ahead. Keep talking.
Okay. You can think about that hunger signal a lot, and it will make you less effective in taking the test if you think about that hunger signal a lot during the test. So what you can do when you get that signal from the body, you'd like appreciate, okay, I got information, I got this signal from my body, and then I can just tune it down. And I know it sounds kind of like silly and like I'm not actually giving you the tool, like, Stacy, just give me the tool, how do you turn it down? But just being aware that you can tune it down and then playing with it, practicing it, you'll start to figure out your own method for doing it. And you really can. And it's not a brute force willpower thing. It's not. It's just an awareness thing. Like, okay, there's the information, thanks for the information, got it, check, keep doing what I'm doing. And so I wanted to preface that whole thing was about signals to the chronic pain. Because in chronic pain, there will be activities that would be less ideal for you. If you have chronic pain, there's a possibility that it's likely that the activities that you're doing could add to the pain. Either just add to the feeling of pain or actually add to the injury, potentially, right?
Mm-hmm. So, yeah. And obviously we're not doctors, so we're just talking to
you. Yeah, we're not doctors.
We're not giving any kind of medical advice or any kind of prescription. So she's talking to just the, how do you manage it when you want to, they were talking about how to improve their health, right? How do you try to improve your health when you're dealing with conditions like that, any kind of signals, fatigue, yes. Ache.
True. We all have signals that are...
But sometimes, like you're pointing out, you might have a situation where you're inflaming an already inflamed condition, and it's going to actually cause injury and inhibit your improving
right.
health.
So in that case,
you're the one who knows.
You know
that.
Yeah. So take that into account when you're listening to the signals and what to pay attention to and not to pay attention to. But try to treat it as information as much as you can, and it will be less painful, if that makes sense.
Yeah, just because the signal comes across at a certain pain level doesn't mean it has to stay at that pain level. Like what Stacey's saying is you can actually tune your attention to the signals of pain versus the, you know, other things, and decide, once you've decided what to do with it, you can kind of let it fall more into the background.
Yeah. Yeah, so once you've decided, let's say you decided the activity is going to be okay for the chronic pain, or vice versa, you decided it wasn't. Either way, once you decide, then you can let that signal kind of, like you said, be in the background more. And we're going to explain so much more during the translation stage, but we really want to honestly answer people's questions as they come up, even if it involves discussing something that the group, we're not really there yet. We're not really in the translation stage yet, but we want to be serious and honestly answer as much as we can the questions. So then the next question is talking about...
One more quick thing. Now that we've covered most of the concepts, with the concept of limitlessness, so even within, you've listened to the signal, you kind of know, what can you do?
Oh, yeah.
Rather than, I can't do anything because I have a signal, it's with you, what you know about your body and what you know about what the signal means, what can you do, and doing as much as you can do. Because, you know, say for example right now, we can't go to the gym. I love going to the gym. I love getting my full workout with the weights and everything like that. I can't do that right now, but what can I do? I can still do body weight exercises. I can still do cardio exercises. What can you do? That kind of focus, right? So
I like that. What can I do? Okay, so then there are two more questions that we wanted to try and end in the next 5 minutes. So what should we do?
Oh, you're good. You're good. Yep.
Okay. So talking about that there were signals and inputs, and this person said, there are so many, you could spend your entire, she quoted me, figuring them out. Mm. And then this person thought about a Cherokee legend of two wolves inside of us, and one who wins, and the one who wins is the one we feed. And then wanting to know, does this go along with your coaching? So talking about the two wolves, and then let's give them the idea of the next question too, was talking about a relationship with a family member and realizing that they had been giving up their joystick to the family member and that it was a struggle. So they asked the question, what things can I begin to say or ponder or write that will help me let go of blaming my mother-in-law?
Do you want me to take the wolf and you can...
Yeah, you take the wolf.
Okay, so you're probably familiar with the legend of the Cherokee that, or whatever, it comes up in different, but it's the idea of you have a bad wolf and a good wolf inside of you, and the one that's going to win is the one that you feed. So the part of that relates to what we've been talking about with signals, because you choose what to pay attention to. And the things that you pay attention to are the things that you will notice more of. So that part definitely fits. That there are some differences, and part of what's cool about the translation stage is contrasting what you understand of another analogy, another principle, and comparing it to figure out what does this new one mean. So the part that's a little bit different about the wolves is this idea that you have to constantly, so if you're thinking of whether or not you're going to feel like the idea that there's the bad and the good in you and one of them's going to win out, that kind of idea, that's a little different than what we're talking about. I like the idea of, you know, who do you feed with your attention? There is a difference when we're talking about the lens and up, between putting silver lining and positive thinking and that kind of stuff. We're going to talk about more like that. So I don't know.
I actually talked about it in my life yesterday.
Oh, you did? Oh my gosh, you always do that. Okay. So anyway, hopefully that answered the question that was posted for that one.
Yes. And then the next one was talking about relationship, and I got really excited when I read it because I'm going to be starting a series of 12 lives on my channel, on my Facebook page, that talk about relationships. And I'm going to talk about toxic debt and the way that debt is used in relationships without even realizing it. And it's really going to answer this. So we don't have as much time maybe right now as I would have liked, but listen to those lives, and then let me just give it a little bit of attention right now. And that is, so one of the things that's helped me a lot is this analogy that I like to view other people as a bookshelf, with the books on their shelf that represent who they are. And let's say they studied in college, they would have all their college textbooks on the bookshelf. Whatever talents or skills they would learn, they would have how to crochet, how to plant your garden, how to, you know, you can imagine all the skills and talents, anything they've spent money or time or energy on in their life, that would be a book on their bookshelf. Any movies they've seen, you know, especially if they're like a specific genre that they like. So all of these things are on their bookshelf. And if you see them as a bookshelf and realize, number one, this helps because it helps you see them, wow, they have so many talents and skills I didn't even think about. Like I didn't, oh my gosh, like they know how to do this and this. And so it helps you see all of the good things that they know, and it also helps you get to know them better. So let's say you don't know them very well, and you're like, oh my gosh, I don't know what books are on their bookshelf. What did they study in college? You know, what movies do they like? So just do that. Those first steps actually really help you to get a kind of a more loving relationship with this person, because you know them, you understand them, you connect with them on, and then you look for similarities, things that you have. But let's say your relationship with this person is struggling, and you feel like they could really benefit from a book on whatever it is that you're struggling with, and you think that they should change. A lot of times when we struggle with a relationship, it's because we want them to change in some way. Mm-hmm. So we want to give them a book, like Etiquette 101. Here you go.
Good one. Okay.
And a lot of times we want to change them, mm-hmm. ideally because we want them to be happier. Mm-hmm. Like that's why. Are deep down, that's why you want people to change, is so they can be happier. And of course, them being happier makes them easier to get along with and has all these positive benefits. So you're actually doing a good thing. You want them to be more happy, right? But we're going about it kind of a little bit wrong if we're trying to put a book on their bookshelf without their permission, or if we're trying to assume that that book is actually what they need. Because their life is completely different than yours. They have different values and talents and abilities. They have different focus, different directions. Even twin sisters or people in the same family would have different focuses. So to say, I know what you need to make you happy, it's not the best way to go about fixing the relationship. So I'll just leave it at that, because I'm going to talk about that a ton. Did you want to say something?
Yeah, I think because we have a few minutes. We wanted to keep it between 20 and 30. So we're in that range between the 20 and the 30.
Let's go.
We can keep going with this.
And we have a bookshelf behind us.
Yeah, we've got. Okay, so part of it is kind of what our intent is with the other person. Part of it is the story we're interpreting from their behavior.
Oh yeah, yeah.
We can't read their thoughts and their motives, and a lot of times, it's what the reason behind why we think, you know, like if someone. You know, does some action. Let's say we're sitting across from each other at the table, and they go like this. If we think that they're trying to say something about us, you know, how we interpret it, what kind of meaning did they do that to make us look bad? Did they do that? Like the story behind why we think they did it is typically where more of the emotions come into play.
Yes.
It's not actually that they touched their face. Oh, they touched. Well, nowadays it can be. Touch their face. Oh no.
Oh, no.
Yeah. Why are they not wearing a mask?
Oh, there you go.
The story that you think about why they are or aren't, that's where some more emotion interpretation happens, because, and realizing the role we play when we fill in the blanks for that, because we're filling in the blanks. So part of this whole relationship question has to do with the story that we're telling ourselves about it. And then she wanted to know, how can she hold the joystick more?
Yes.
Especially when she's been giving the joystick to this other person so often. Every time this person says X or does Y, in the past, she has felt like it has taken her emotions and played with them. So how do you practice? What can she think about? What can she do to acknowledge her role and her ability to keep the joystick when she's gonna come across the same person, probably same behaviors?
Yes, yes, and one thing you can do is you can actually anticipate the situation that you're going into and think, okay, this is a trigger for me. This, when they do this, then this is something I do reactively. And so to make a list of all the things that may happen. Mm, okay, mm-hmm. Maybe they're gonna do this, maybe they're gonna do this, maybe they're gonna do this. Mm-hmm. And then actually say, if they do this, how could I keep my joystick? And I don't know why, but just proactively yeah. going in there, you change your mindset. You're, instead of like reactive and frustrated, you're curious. You're like, what could I do? What if I do this? What if I do this? And then mm-hmm. it's a game, and it just changes everything.
It's a different approach, very yeah. different approach. And that's just knowing, like what Stacey just described, when you think of it that way, I can see, like, you're not thinking that person is making me feel this way. Mm-hmm. You've created a completely different paradigm about what's happening. They're not making you feel this way. They're behaving, and you have a joystick, you have a lens about how to interpret, you have your sense, your ability, like that model will completely change what that person's behavior means.
Yeah.
And how it affects you.
Yes. Like definitely. It
completely. So how do they, what can they do? So you said they could list off all of the things
that typically they are reactive and get that feeling of
yep.
not owning their joystick. And go into it proactively and okay. actually come up with ways that they can, what they could do. What could I do when they say this? What could I do when they do this? Mm-hmm. And so then you're curious and creative mm-hmm. instead of reactive and frustrated.
Okay. And then what could they do as far as the lens and the joystick that they could think about before they go into it that would help them kind of remember what power they do have?
Specifically or in
yeah.
general.
Yeah. Well, in general, like, how does the lens help them? How does the joystick idea help them in that kind of situation?
Okay, so just knowing that you are, okay, so this is so cool. Okay, so your lens is your reality. It's the way you perceive things, just the thing just is. And when we say inspect the lens, look at the lens, it means look at what you perceive as your reality. And just that step of looking at the lens, the thing that you perceive as your reality, it changes it to not just be reality. It changes it to be your perception of reality, which you could change. So I think maybe even imagine it looking through a new lens, you know, putting on yellow sunglasses or pink sunglasses and go, oh, this just changed everything. This just changed my reality.
Okay, so. Well, we have hit time, so okay, we have a little bit more.
Well, we're yeah. trying to. Okay.
I'm gonna. What?
This is really, really mind. Yeah.
And this is, by the way, stage three, just a little kind of a teaser for stage three.
Oh,
when we get to stage three, we're going to go into much more detail about how you implement change. How do you actually make this stuff turn into application, into how you live your life, not just theory. Even though we're in stage two and talking about making it your words and your translation, we're still in the theory stage. Stage three is application, and when we hit application, we're going to talk much more about how you turn these things into actual behavior and how you make it instinctive and easy. So
what I should have said when he asked me is I should have said, oh, you're asking me a how question. Ooh, we save how questions for stage three.
Like, we can give you kind of tips and boosts and stuff like that, but until we actually get to the how stage, our questions, our answers are going to seem incomplete because they are.
Yes.
It's an incomplete answer.
Yes.
It is.
Yeah. So teaser for stage three, guys.
Okay, thanks everyone for coming.
Yeah, thank you.
And we'll see you next week for another Q&A every Friday.
And look for our playground post. We aren't going to start it this week. We're going to start it next week. But look for it next week. And any questions or comments or things that you think would be of benefit to the group, then put them in that post on Fridays.
Cool.
So.
All right.
Okay, take care,
everyone. Thanks, everyone. Take care.
Bye.